Bulgaria. When you first meet her, you might get the wrong message. Remember, here a no might mean yes. Not that she's trying to confuse you. She's inviting you to get to know her yourself. Nature smiles at us with the beauty of all four seasons. Our country is the coast of inspiration. We enjoy her harmony and keep on dreaming. One sea and more than 30 mountain ranges. They listen and keep our stories. Our grannies do not understand organic food. It is simply food for them. Everything is genuinely natural in their gardens. We are famous for our hospitality and joy when we share our homemade dishes. We keep our traditions alive, and often it is the other way around. It is traditions that keep us alive. We cherish centuries-old rituals, exciting, scary, mysterious. We do everything to health. We even drink to health. На здраве! The history of Bulgaria is so old that sometimes even we tend to forget it. And yet, we appeared on the map more than 13 centuries ago. We are proud of writing it with our own letters of the Cyrillic alphabet. Our culture is as rich as our history's ancient. We live at crossroads where East meets West, where civilization meets mysticism. Even if it sounds to you like a clash of extremes, to us it means an invaluable encounter, because we know how to make the best of both worlds. Bulgarians are strong in spirit and believe in a better tomorrow. We do not wait for it to come to us. We work hard to get there. We improve day in and day out. And in doing so, we are helped by the fastest internet in Europe. We have an opinion on everything, but we will be glad to hear yours too. Don't hesitate to send us a friendship request. We always have a place for one more among us. This is Bulgaria. She can be late. She's sometimes messy, and you can't always understand her. She's beautiful, warm, and hospitable. It is precisely because of her contrasts and heavenly beauty that you can't help falling in love with her at first sight. Her greatest wealth is her people, genuine and frank. And since we know that it is the people who make a place, we firmly believe that, indeed, united, we stand strong.
Eleven years after its accession to the European Union, Bulgaria takes over the presidency of the Council of the European Union for the first time. The Council is one of the key institutions of the Union, and our country will be the main broker in the European decision-making process for 6 months. Bulgaria will seek a balance between different points of view and interests for the benefit of all European citizens. For 6 months, our country will focus on four priorities. Bulgaria will work for a clear European perspective for the countries from the Western Balkans. Being close peoples and good neighbors, we need connectivity in terms of transport, energy, education, and digital connectivity. Connectivity not only between us, but with the member states too. This is the road to lasting peace, security, and prosperity in the region. Bulgaria will work for more security and stability in a strong and united Europe. Today, Europe needs to cooperate through shared efforts in its security policy and on the topic of migration. Bulgaria will work for a digital economy. The era of digital technology presupposes that the education of young people should be linked to acquiring the skills for the future. This is the way to achieving a competitive, flexible and successful Europe. The digital single market, access to innovation, and the link between education and the requirements of the labour market are at the core of future development. Bulgaria will work for the future of Europe and of young people. In all its actions, Bulgaria will put young people first. The European economy is accelerating. New jobs are being created. Investment is growing. Public finances are strengthening. But it is young people who are the most valuable investment and the true asset for the future. The Bulgarian presidency will work for the people. European citizens expect specific solutions to specific problems. The key to resolving them and to attaining our common goals is unity. Tomorrow, Europe will be such as we make it today. And today, Europe is in need of more security, stability, and solidarity.
Но че след ли малки ерови там някакви къщи сте ми обещали на Кирил и Методи, да видим какво правим с това.
Уважаеми дами и господа, уважаеми колеги, гости, партньори, добре дошли на днешната конференция, организирана от Министерството на труда и социалната политика за бъдещето на труда, като част от инициативите на българското председателство. И тъй като сме в София и в България, всяко наше събитие започва с българските традиции, които всички ние ценим, които искаме да запазим и са част от нашата европейска ценност.
Patata, na gore, na dole, taka.
Благодаря много за прекрасното изпълнение на децата от музикалното училище в София. Това са младите таланти на България, които съхраняват националните ценности, но са и бъдещето на България, и бъдещето на Европа. Затова днес решихме, че днешния и утрешен ден можем да посветим на дебата за бъдещето на труда с участието от много колеги от страни членки, партньори от работодателските организации, от синдикалните организации, частни фирми, местните власти, неправителствения сектор, защото това е тема, която предстои всички ние в Европа с предизвикателствата на демографската криза, с развитието на IT сектора, с по-големия дял на споделената икономика, с динамиката на развитието на света, да започнем все повече да обсъждаме. През 18 век Волтер е казал, че труда освобождава човека от трите най-големи злини – скуката, порока и бедността. Труда обаче днес е съвсем различен. Днес говорим за динамика, говорим за различни начини на заплащане, говорим за дигитализация, говорим за умения, говорим за това до каква степен човек може да съвмести личния си и професионалния си живот с работата и до каква степен всички ние, правителства, работодателски организации, синдикати, партньори, трябва все повече да обсъждаме темата за нашите предизвикателства, така че да настроим системите си за образование, да настроим системите си за подкрепа на политиките на пазара на труда и да подготвим Европа за предизвикателствата на бъдещето на труда. България е изключително известна с много силен IT сектор, известна на европейско ниво с много жени, които участват в IT сектора. Затова днес за вдъхновяващо слово сме поканили Светлин Нанков, който е съосновател, изпълнител и управител на Софтуерния университет в България. Заповядайте.
Здравейте всички. I'll talk in English. Dear ministers, dear mayor, dear politicians, dear international guests, I'm really happy that every one of you is here in Sofia, because I believe that the future of labor is related to the future of our life as general. So I believe that we already entered to the economy of knowledge. And in the economy of knowledge, a major transformation in the labor market is being done in the latest years, and this will increase in the future. And I believe that the low-qualified jobs will be lost and are being lost constantly, and they will be changed by the high-quality people. The labor does not need workers, just people who do something which is now replaced by robots, replaced by automation, by artificial intelligence systems, by machine learning and things like that. I'm sure that maybe 20 or 30 years later we'll have taxi drivers, for example, we'll have autonomous drivers, we'll have mobility as a service, we'll have everything done through the digital skills, through the digital technologies, and this is the major direction that we see every day in the labor's market. So what does this mean? This means that people will need higher skills, not just to learn to serve coffee, but to learn how to design artificial intelligence systems, how to be more than the machine, because machines are the repeating instrument. They learn from, for example, car driving is learned by examples, by drivers who drive, but they cannot react well in unknown situations where they don't have experience. So, well, new jobs will arrive, and they are started to arrive. In 2030, it expected that 85% of the jobs will be jobs that currently does not exist, jobs which are currently unknown, not already born. It is 85%. So I believe that professions like coach of robots, artificial intelligence security expert, or criminal people who will do with the criminal problems with the robots, so things like that will arise, and many things will be changed. So the labor in its classical form is just disappearing. It's being transformed to something new. And I'm questioning myself whether we shall have at this time a ministry of the labor, or it will become nonsense. Why do we have this? Because the low-quality jobs will be done by robots, by automation, and the high-quality jobs will be done by smart people, well-educated, well-prepared. And the others will just survive due to the social system. Maybe there will be some kind of social system ministry, and the other piece of it will be some kind of the ministry of the talent or the ministry of the skills development, something like this. This is just my thinking about what is coming in the future. Because I'm a digital skills expert, and I believe that digital skills is like language skills and like reading and writing skills. It's non-discussion, it's just you need it. So how to prepare for this future is the main question that we can talk, discuss, and later take direct actions. I believe that the future is high-quality education, a new style of education, because the old system, which is based on remembering and repeating something, does not work in the modern era. It does not work today, and companies and business does not need these people. These people are called now robots, and we have them. We have them in the, for example, car manufacturing industry, and they will be moved elsewhere. For example, we'll have autonomous restaurants without cookers, without people, just robots. You enter, put your mobile phone, because credit cards will be no longer used in 10 years, where the blockchain will come, and things like that. So our education need to produce new skills, skills like to learn to think, to learn to change, to learn to transform, to learn to adapt. And I ask everyone, how do we teach these skills now? And do we at all? How we really prepare for this future? Because the technologies are entering in the education, and they change the education. Learning by game playing is something that we need to use instead to avoid it and say the children, don't play this game. No, we need educational games, in fact. Things like that. So I have found two successful models which are really contradictory. The final one model, where the government monopoly over the education is driving a really innovative system where people learn by some kind of untraditional techniques, and this works well, it's proven. And also the UK and Israel model, where the education is driven entirely by the private institution, and they have a real freedom to decide what to teach, how to teach, whether the people will go to school or not, and the government just certifies some kinds of skills and say, do it in your way. I believe the second will work better in Bulgaria, because we don't use even the first nor the latest model. And I really believe that education is the future of labor. We need to invest. Thank you.
Благодаря много на Светлин Нанков за вдъхновяващите слова и особено за последните думи, че трябва да инвестираме в образованието. Защото днешните деца първо започват да работят със смартфоните преди да се научат да четат. И ние трябва да отговаряме наистина на предизвикателствата и на демографията, и на това, което ни очаква с дигитализацията. За мен е чест като домакин на нашето председателство да дам думата на госпожа Йорданка Фандъкова, кмет на София, жена кмет повече от 8 години вече, човек, който е изключително свързан и с нашата тема от гледна точка на образованието, от гледна точка на професионалната си кариера и човек, който превърна София в един прекрасен град. Заповядайте, госпожо Фандъкова.
Уважаема госпожо Русинова, уважаеми госпожи и господа, за мен е чест да поздравя всички гости с добре дошли в нашия град, както и всички присъстващи представители на работодателските, синдикалните организации, неправителствените организации, всички наши партньори, с които работим заедно с провеждането на тази конференция. Позволете ми да поздравя и българското председателство и Министерството на труда и социалната политика на България и лично госпожа Русинова за инициативата за тази конференция и за темата, която за мен е темата на темите. Това е темата за бъдещето. Бъдещето на нашите деца, бъдещето на нашите градове. Това всеки човек да има възможността да изяви себе си, да изяви най-доброто от себе си, да реализира своите възможности и своя потенциал. Безспорно, предизвикателствата са изключително големи, но ще се съглася с това, което казаха преди малко, че най-важното по тази тема, това е образованието. Образованието, но въпросът е какво образование? Какво трябва да направим, за да дадем възможност на всички деца, без значение на техните възможности, да изявят себе си, да се подготвят за това, което ги очаква. А всъщност никой не знае от нас какво точно очаква нашите деца след 10, след 15 години. Така че тази тема е изключително важна и наистина се радвам, че имам възможност да участвам в конференцията. През последните години София се развива изключително динамично, както между другото и всички столици и големи градове в цяла Европа. Тенденциите са такива, ние знаем това. Това от една страна е чудесно, от друга страна обаче ни поставя пред редица предизвикателства. През последните години София влезе в престижни международни класации, като през 2015 година влезе в топ 30 на най-бързо развиващите се градове в класация от 300 града на JP Morgan Chase. За последните 10 години София е европейската столица с най-голям ръст на брутния вътрешен продукт според изследване на фондация Bloomberg. София произвежда 40% от брутния вътрешен продукт в страната. Всичко това, разбира се, постигаме благодарение на изключително целенасочената политика, която има градът, на партньорството с бизнеса, с неправителствения сектор, с университетите. За всичко това, разбира се, благодаря на всички, които допринасят. Но, както вече казах, това, че градът се развива динамично, ни изправя и пред редица предизвикателства. София все повече привлича граждани от цялата страна. Близо 21% от децата в България, родени през 2016 година, са родени именно тук, в нашия град. Друга отличителна способност на града ни, която е основа за бързото развитие на града, е концентрацията на високообразовани кадри. Това е изключително важно. Над 50% от заетите в нашия град са с висше образование. През 2016 година работната сила в София е една пета от тази в страната, а заетостта е най-високата в нашата страна, като заетите са над 72%. Безработицата трайно в последните години е около и под 3%, като последните икономически анализи сочат, че София вече осигурява работни места за живеещите в съседни градове и общини. Сериозен е ръстът на заетите и на работните места в IT-индустрията, което е следствие на бурното развитие на този сектор в България. София се нареди в топ-3 на европейските градове по стартиращи компании в IT-сектора. Всичко това са огромни възможности за града ни, за младите хора да остават, да работят тук, да реализират най-доброто от себе си и, разбира се, да имат по-добър стандарт и по-добро, по-високо качество на живот. Ниската безработица обаче отваря и редица предизвикателства пред бизнеса и пред пазара на труда като цяло. Всички ние вече усещаме липсата на кадри, липсата на добре подготвени кадри и отново се връщаме към най-важната тема, темата за образованието и то на децата от най-ранна възраст. Като областта с най-голям брой население и съответно с най-много деца, в София функционират и най-много общински детски градини и училища от различен тип и от различни образователни степени. В столицата работят общо от 231 общо образователни училища. Ние продължаваме да изграждаме училища. През последните години построихме 3 нови. В момента разширяваме съществуващи училища и проектираме строителството на още 4. Общината управлява и поддържа над 220 общински детски градини, като те наистина предлагат едно много високо качество и възможност за ранно детско развитие. Много от тях работят по конкретни проекти в тази сфера. Строим сериозно и усилено. През последните години построихме близо 90 нови детски градини. Продължаваме да строим. В момента в строеж са 8 нови детски градини. През 2017 година имаме доста голям напредък по отношение обхвата на децата в детските градини, защото за мен като експерт и професионалист винаги е било важно децата да могат да посещават и да се включат в предучилищното образование, за да могат след това да имат равен достъп до училище. Към момента имаме 100% обхват на 5 и 6 годишните деца в предучилищното образование, над 90% обхват на децата между 3 и 5 годишна възраст. Това наистина е впечатляващ резултат. Въпреки това, ние се стремим да осигурим 100% достъп на децата в тази възраст, защото и едно семейство да няма възможност да изпрати детето си на детска градина, това за мен вече е проблем, а за родителите още по-голям. В същото време работим усилено и за още по-ранния обхват. В момента имаме над 60% обхват на децата в детските ясли, т.е. до 3 годишна възраст. Всички, които се занимават в тази сфера, знаят, че това е един наистина сериозен резултат, въпреки че всички млади родители в София са притеснени, които са в рамките на останалите 40%. Както вече казах, нашата амбиция е да осигурим 100% обхват на възрастта между 3 и 6 години и чувствително да напреднем при най-малките. През учебната 2016-2017 година 6 общински детски градини бяха включени в проект «Да отключим потенциала». Това е един малък пример за работа за развитието на децата от най-ранна възраст. Особено усилие полагаме за това да дадем възможност на всички деца, без значение на техните особености, да получат достъп и възможност до образование. През последните години Столичната община разкри 63 услуги, делегирани от държавата дейности в подкрепа на деца и семейства, като в по-голяма част от тези услуги ние работим заедно с изключително сериозни, отговорни неправителствени организации, които имат много сериозен капацитет и предлагат различен вид качествени услуги. Със сигурност ще стане дума за тази тема и на конференцията днес и утре. Надявам се, защото София има доста добри модели, имаме иновативни модели, развиваме социални иновации, разработихме програма за първа година, която ще финансира проекти по линия на социални иновации, така че разчитаме, че в следващите години с партньорството на всички, които работят в тази сфера, ще можем да осигурим още по-добри и качествени услуги. Вярвам, че днес и утре ще има сериозни дискусии, ще обменим опита с всички страни в Европейския съюз. Този опит за нас е безценен. Още веднъж благодаря на госпожа Русинова за организацията на тази конференция и ще очаквам с нетърпение резултати, които да ни позволят да продължим развитието на нашия град и най-вече на нашите деца с по-бързи темпове. Пожелавам успех на конференцията.
Благодаря много на госпожа Фандъкова за прекрасното откриване и за домакинстването на цялото председателство, както и за днешната конференция. С нас, разбира се, благодарение на модерните технологии е нашия еврокомисар по въпросите на заетостта, социалното дело, уменията и трудовата мобилност Мариана Тисен. За съжаление, тя нямаше как да присъства в София, защото днес се провежда по същото време среща на върха с участието на социалните партньори в Брюксел. Това е причината и за отсъствието на министър Петков от днешното заседание. Така че нека да чуем видеоното обращението на Мариан Тисен.
Grateful to the Bulgarian presidency for organizing this conference on a topic that affects each and every one of us, the future of work. While I could unfortunately not join you in person today, I am happy to be able to contribute to your discussions and further reflections. Indeed, this discussion could not be more timely. At a time when we are already faced with the pressures of demographic change, and digitalization and artificial intelligence are transforming the world of work. We cannot and should not stop these changes. Robots and algorithms will create growth and jobs. There will be progress in medicine, science, and technology. In many ways, the future looks bright. New forms of work emerge on digital platforms and the collaborative economy. The result is more flexibility, improved work-life balance, and of course, supplementary income. But there will be also profound challenges of a new social and digital divide. The way we perform different tasks or deliver services will evolve, and it is the middle-skilled jobs that can most easily be automated. If we do nothing, these people will be out of a job soon, and a new social divide will appear. At the same time, the more flexible work arrangements may not be as regular or stable as traditional employment relations. This may create uncertainty as to applicable rights and the level of social protection. We cannot sit idly by. Instead, we must harness the digital revolution, shape these changes ourselves, and create the future we want, a dynamic, fair and social Europe. Our guide for building a more social Europe is the European Pillar of Social Rights. In November, we made history, social history. The European Commission, the European Parliament, and the Member States proclaimed our Pillar of Social Rights. And together we reaffirmed our commitment to build a more social Europe ready for the 21st century. The pillar is a framework of 20 rights and principles grouped around three main goals: equal opportunities and access to the labor market through education, training, and lifelong learning, fair working conditions for all, and access to social protection for all. The pillar will act as a compass to navigate the new world of work, a guide to get our people ready and our institutions ready for the digital age. The first principle of the pillar is education, training and lifelong learning. And that's not for nothing. We need to boost skills and fast. 90% of jobs require digital skills, but only 4 out of 10 Europeans have those skills. Through our new skills agenda, we are boosting basic literacy, numerical and digital skills. And we are also boosting the highly specialized skills that the new economy needs. We are also making our rule book future-proof. Flexible work is replacing the old, permanent 9-to-5 contract. Flexibility is good, but it should not result to uncertainty. That's why I am proposing a directive that will make working conditions transparent and predictable. And we need to modernize social protection. Our systems have been developed on the model of standard employment. This means that they do not cope with the realities of the new world of work and the needs of non-standard workers and self-employed. Just last week, I presented a proposal on social protection for everyone. Concretely, everyone in employment should have the opportunity to contribute to a social protection scheme and have access to adequate protection. Ladies and gentlemen, the Commission is doing its bit. I now call on the Member States and social partners to support my proposals and together to implement the pillar of social rights, each according to our competences, so that Europe will stay social and competitive, and that we may meet the challenges posed by change and reap the rewards of progress. I wish you a very successful conference.
Благодарим много на комисар Тейсен за откриващите и вдъхновяващи думи. Предизвикателствата пред всички нас са големи. Когато се подготвях за днешната конференция, попаднах на най-изключително интересна статия на BBC от началото на тази година, която ни припомня за историята на нашите страхове и историята на нашите предвиждания как ще се развива в труда, и ще цитирам няколко факта. През 4 век преди новата ера Сократ предвижда, че писмеността ще заличи спомените на хората. Ще ни накара да престанем толкова да помним, защото ще разчитаме на писмеността. През 15 век един монах споделя, че с откриването на печатницата монасите ще останат без работа и ще станат безработни. Малко по-късно, през 1926 година, в едно католическо училище се предполага, че телефоните ще убият срещите лице в лице. През 50-та година Associated Press публикува една статия, в която казва, че жените ще станат гиганти. През 2000-та година се очаква, че жените ще вземат позиция на високо ниво в сферата на финансите, бизнеса, управлението, че ще носят 40 номер обувки и ще имат широки плещи като борци. Каква е реалността и какво ни очаква? Към нас се присъединява с видеообращение и генералният директор на МОД Гай Райдер. Знаете, че темата за бъдещето на труда е една от темите, която е в фокуса на Международната организация на труда, и ще завършат дебатите през следващата година, когато честваме 100 години от създаването на Международната организация на труда.
Ministers, Commissioner, representatives of European institutions, representatives of employers and workers' organizations, dear friends, thank you for the opportunity to address this high-level conference on the future of work organized by the Government of Bulgaria in the framework of this, its first EU presidency.
I think that your conference is further proof of the shared values and objectives of the EU and the ILO, which has been the basis for our strengthened and productive cooperation in recent years. The future of work is at the heart of the ILO's activities to mark its centenary next year. And like the EU, we recognise that the world of work is undergoing profound and transformative change. And like the EU, we believe that we need to understand these processes of change, to be able to shape them to the demands of fairness at work, shared prosperity for all, and ultimately of social justice, upon which lasting peace and stability depends. The ILO's Centenary Initiative on the Future of Work has involved more than 110 national dialogues, followed by the establishment last August of a high-level global commission, co-chaired by the Prime Minister of Sweden and the President of Mauritius. The commission met for the second time in Geneva last month, and it's progressing well and is anxious to reach out to others who are working on the future of work. It will publish its report at the beginning of 2019 and is determined to make that report concise, action-oriented and impactful. The speed and the extent of change at work is above all associated with technological innovation, digitalization, artificial intelligence, robots and all the rest. But there is much else to be factored in as well. Demography, climate change and globalization, for example. And when taken together, these drivers of change are fueling notable levels of uncertainty and even fear among citizens in Europe and in other regions. Part of this is about basic human reactions to the rapid approach of the unknown and the non-understood. But it's also a consequence of the growing inequalities and tough labour market conditions which many are living with right now and which they fear will get worse in the future. And it comes from the feeling that policymakers, governments and social partners are having difficulty in anticipating and in guiding change in the direction that people want it to move. Which is why your conference is so important, and it's why all these issues are at the top of the global policy agenda. At the European level, the Commission's Skills Agenda for Europe, the Package on Modernising Education Youth Initiative, and the Digital Agenda for 2020, together with the European Pillar of Social Rights, are substantive platforms to promote well-functioning labour markets that can deliver decent work and social justice for the future. At the EBSCO meeting held in September last year, I would recall, the Estonian presidency emphasised the role of digitalisation and the potential of creating an advanced e-society. And following on from that discussion, Bulgaria's presidency has rightly identified the future of youth and digital technology as among its main priorities. I think that this balanced approach allows for addressing the changes and technological challenges facing labour markets whilst integrating the human and social dimension of the future of work. The comprehensive life cycle approach chosen for this conference captures very well the essence of the challenges facing Europe. And let me comment that many of the issues on your conference agenda reflect very closely those which our Global Commission are focusing upon and underline the importance of tripartite dialogue with the social partners in identifying fair and workable policy responses. So your reflections will be a major contribution to the work of the ILO Global Commission and, of course, to the EU's own deliberations as you prepare for the next informal meeting of the Ministers of Employment and Social Policy in April. And that will consider, of course, related issues on the future of work and the future of Europe. I look forward then to hearing the results of your discussions, and I wish you a very successful conference. Thank you.
Благодарим и на Гай Райдер за приветствените думи. Наистина, четирите теми, които в днешния ден и утрешния ден ще дискутираме, в контекста на демографските предизвикателства пред бъдещето на труда, ролята на практическите знания и умения от гледна точка на инвестициите в ранни детско развитие, уменията за нови работни места, както и условията на труд, ще бъдат приноса, който ще имаме и към дебата на министрите през юни месец по време на съвета, както и към дебата по отношение на бъдещето на труда в рамките на Международната организация на труда. Днес ще започнем нашата конференция с две сесии паралелни. Накратко бих искала да представя нашите модератори. Първата сесия ще обхване всички теми, свързани с демографските предизвикателства и бъдещето на труда. Модератор на първата сесия е Кристиан Бодевик, програмен ръководител за включващ растеж в страните членки на Европейския съюз от Световната банка. Дългогодишен координатор на банките, на програмите на банката по проблемите на пазара на труда, образованието, здравето, бедността и социалната защита. И много добър приятел на България, така че за нас е удоволствие той да модерира тази сесия. А по-късно след обед, сесията посветена на инвестициите в ранно детско развитие, ролята на практическите знания и умения на децата, ще бъде модерирана от госпожа Дипа Гровър, старши съветник в областта на ранното детско развитие в Регионалния офис за Европа и Централна Азия на УНЕЦЕФ. Желая успех на всички панелисти. Надявам се да имаме изключително успешна дискусия днес. Успех! Заповядай, Кристиан.
Thank you very much, Deputy Minister Rusinova. It is a pleasure for me to welcome you to this panel, the first panel of the conference. And it's a pleasure indeed for me personally to be back in Sofia, a city where I lived and worked a decade ago. Anchoring a conference on the future of work in demographic change and demographic challenges makes a lot of sense. Why? Demographic change interacts very powerfully with the other big mega trend that that Svetlin Nakov was very good at articulating at the beginning, technological change in shaping the future of work. As we're getting fewer and fewer, and as we are living longer, we need to become more productive, and we need to work longer working lives in order to not undermine the effect of demographic change on growth and our fiscal outlook. But how are we going to do that in an environment where technological change is disruptive, where technological change means the loss of employment and disruption of the labor market? Just this week, Darren Acemoglu of MIT and Pascal Restrepo of Boston University published a paper that shows that demographic change and aging actually promotes automation. And they find that robotization is more pronounced in countries that are aging faster. And that comes at the expense of employment prospects of middle-aged workers. At the World Bank last week, we launched a report on the European Union called Growing United, which argues that technological change drives a wedge between the highly skilled and the less well-skilled, which ultimately may put convergence in the European Union at risk. So as we are discussing and thinking about how we can all work longer, those of us who can work longer, does it really make sense to think about how to extend longer working lives, in fact, if automation is interfering in this way with the labor market? Is there a trade-off between automation and our prospects of working longer? So these are some of the questions that we're going to discuss at this panel. And we are going to have the panel first informed by a number of presentations that look at different dimensions of the demographic change, followed then by an interactive discussion between different social partners and experts. So let me begin with introducing the presenters who are going to launch us off. First of all, to my right, Claire Harasty is a senior employment specialist at the ILO. To her right, Eva Meidel is a member of the European Parliament from Bulgaria and a passionate advocate of education. Krista Sedlacek is the director of the European Agency for Safety and Health at Work. And Joanna Goody is the head of Freedoms and Justice Department at the EU Agency for Fundamental Rights. So we're going to have these presentations, after which we open for a panel discussion. Claire, the word, you have the floor.
Thank you. It is a pleasure for me to be here with you today. I will talk to you about a trend that will impact the future of work tremendously. And in fact, it is a trend that is already, this is not working, talking about technology. Oh yes, it is okay. So in fact, this trend is already impacting us very much, and this is the aging of the population, the aging of our societies. On this map, you see the situation in 2015. The dark blue countries have already aged, which means that the share of people over 65 in their total population exceeds 14%. And you can see that Europe is in that situation. Now you see the situation in 2050. Societies across the world will almost all have aged by then, except for sub-Saharan Africa. So the world is getting older, and this has important implications for the future of work. The first implication is that there will be a need for a lot of people to care for the elderly, and also for a range of new industries and services, like specific construction industry, pharmaceuticals, and services going with that, that will be adapted to the elderly. And this will create large numbers of job opportunities that will require new skills, and hence we will need to provide these skills. And these are jobs, most of the time, that cannot be replaced by machines. The proportion of people above 50 years old in the total population will increase significantly until 2050 in all regions of the world. That's the graph on the left-hand side. I don't know if it's easy to read for you. Will all these people above 50, between 50 and 60, will they all work, and whether by choice or necessity? And if they do work, in what conditions? Our projections in the ILO show that the great majority of these people will work. And you see on the right-hand side the graph that shows the size of the labor force, age 55 to 64. It will increase until now in 2050. The green line is the developed countries. And you will see that it will increase sharply until 2050. So what are these numbers? These are the labor force participation rates of people above 50 and below 65 in 2050. And in comparison, you can see that in 2010 in the EU, the blue numbers, we had the blue numbers. So we see a sharp increase of the labor force participation rate of people 55 to 64. So I'm not talking about an extension of working lives here, but just of people as they work today. And this brings me to the second implication of aging societies on the labor market and the world of work. There will be more people, more older workers in the labor force, which will require adaptations in the way we work. And these are adaptations in terms of work organization, occupational safety and health, working time, and other such issues. On this graph, you see that more women aged 55 to 64 will be active in the labor market. The gender gap will hence decrease, but will not disappear. So we also see feminization of the labor force above 55. Now, public debate places a lot of attention to the impact of aging on dependency ratios, that is, the number of people who do not work compared to the number of people who work. These ratios will increase in countries with increasing numbers of people over 65, as people over 65 are not counting as working. This could lead to slower economic growth and place the financing of social protection in danger. And this is the third implication of aging societies that I want to highlight today. The standard age-based dependency ratio, which is basically the children below 15, the older people above 65 compared to all those in between. This measure does not, however, capture well the situation that we have. It doesn't take into account all those who are of working age, but either do not work because they're inactive, or are active but unemployed, or are employed but not productively employed. So this is why we are proposing some alternative dependency measures that will tell us more about what is the situation in the labor market when aging. This graph summarizes the four different dependency measures that we are talking about. The first one, very difficult to read, but okay, I'll explain, is the basic dependency ratio, which only reflects the age structure of the population, and you see it is about 40 people not working, 400 people working. If we add inactivity levels, so all those who are of working age but are not participating in the labor market, you see the dependency ratio increasing tremendously. If we add the unemployed, it increases a bit more. And if we add the what we call here the quality of employment, so all those who are not in employment that is productive enough, vulnerable types of employment or non-standard forms of employment or involuntary part-time, etc., the dependency ratio increases even more. So when we add all these dimensions that better reflect the capacity of those who work to support the rest of the population, dependency ratios increase significantly. We are also able to disaggregate these dependency ratios to see the contribution of different groups to the total dependency. Here we see that in developed country, in the left-hand graph, the yellow line shows the contribution of older people above 65, while the gray line shows the contribution of children. We see that, of course, aging is, the contribution is increasing and it will be greater than that of children. But what we see above all is the orange line, which represents inactivity and unemployment, which has the greatest contribution to dependency. So this leads us to the conclusion that there is a need to increase activity rates and fight unemployment in order to counterbalance the effect of aging on the dependency ratio, which we see increasing. So increasing employment rates would be a key action to counterbalance aging. If we continue disaggregating this measure, yes, here we have disaggregated the dependency ratios to show the inactivity rates of youth, male and female, inactivity rate of adults, male and female, unemployment of men and women, own account workers and other vulnerable workers, male and female. And this is very useful in seeing, okay, what are the levers that we have to counterbalance aging. Here you see in green the aging, it's increasing, but what we see is the dark blue is the inactivity rate of women, for example, and we also see that the unemployment is quite important. So again, if we can act on the inactivity rate of women and on decreasing unemployment and mainly youth unemployment, then we can counterbalance the impact of aging on the dependency. And this shows the importance of having an active employment policy to promote full employment. So some conclusions to summarize a little bit what I've said. Aging is there, and this trend is very pregnant in Europe already. To counterbalance its effect, it is important to set clear objectives in terms of employment rates disaggregated by sex so as to be able to have more women participating in the labor force. This will help counterbalance the impact of aging on the labor market. But that isn't enough. Improving the quality of this employment, it's not any employment and that will solve the problem. Improving the quality of this employment will be a necessity to avoid a steep increase in the dependency rates, as we have seen on the graphs that the vulnerable part also has an impact. So there will be a need to encourage and support work-life balance so as to enable more women to join and remain in the labor force, but also there will be a need to better integrate older workers, those aged between 55 and 64, in the labor market. And there are a range of policies here that can be pursued to do that. I will leave that for the discussion, and I thank you for your attention.
Claire, thank you very much for setting the scene for us in terms of giving the outlook and the dimensions of the demographic change that we are looking at. Boosting employment takes many policy levers working together, but one policy lever is, of course, very critical, which is education and skills. So with this, let me pass over to Eva Meidel to talk about skills.
Thank you very much. Christian, I'll start in Bulgarian. Having the Bulgarian presidency and being in Sofia as a Bulgarian myself, it's quite nice to be able to use my own language. Уважаеми дами и господа, скъпи приятели на развитието на работните места на бъдещето, голямо удоволствие за мен да се присъединя към днешната конференция и бих искала да благодаря специално на заместник-министър Русинова и на българското председателство за поканата и за организирането на една много важна и близка до мен лично и до моето сърце тема, така че аз може би ще използвам малко по-малко графики и повече имиджи, които мисля, че показват развитието на бъдещето на работата. Хората винаги са търсили смисъл в съществуването си и през вековете такъв смисъл може би са давали религията, политическото или обществените течения, на които сме били свидетели. През последния половин век обаче влиянието на всеки от тези фактори намалява и хората все повече осмислят живота си чрез работа. Границите между работното и неработното време, между работна и неработна среща, между наработен или неработен разговор се разминават наистина до толкова, че работата се превръща в най-важния елемент от нашия живот и един от факторите, който определя начинът, по който нашето общество съществува и се развива. Всички твърдят, че нашия трудов пазар се променя с такава скорост и навлизащи технологии се развива толкова бързо, че един 12-13 годишен младеж няма да има никаква представа той какво ще работи, но също така и какви умения ще му трябват. Аз наричам това ново поколение, поколението, което смята, че таблета идва преди телевизора, защото не е смятал, че може таблета да не съществува преди да сме имали телевизия. Но аз мисля, че тук по-големият проблем всъщност е не толкова, че младежът не знае какво ще работи, а проблемът са неговите родители. Защото младежът има наистина предимството да бъде от така нареченото дигитално поколение, което не помни света без интернет. Но за сметка на това неговите родители, за тях не е естествено да докосват екрана и да плъзгат ръката си по него, за да сменят страницата, например. И точно за това смятам, че адаптирането към работата в 21 век е много по-голямо предизвикателство за тези, които познават работата си от 20 век. Точно за това, може би, най-важното умение, което всеки един от нас трябва да приеме, за да бъде успешен не само в работата си, но и в живота си като цяло, е и умението да притежава възможността да учи непрекъснато. Тоест да се научим как да учим. Днес не е важно дали имаме и разполагаме с определена информация, защото знаем колко е лесно достъпа до нея. Много по-важно е как да извлечем нужното от огромният обем заобикаляща ни информация и този бъз, който имаме от информация около нас. В свят, в който най-често използваният източник на информация е онлайн пространството и уебсайтовете, всеки може да редактира свободно и няма нужда да заучва факти. Точно за това имаме нужда от голяма доза критично мислещи хора. Хора, които умеят да правят анализи, да синтезират и да отсяват информацията. В допълнение с това, те имат нужда от комуникативни и презентационни умения, за да могат правилно да я представят и да се обосноват, познавайки вече информацията. Аз смятам, че хората от политиката трябва да адаптират образованието към нуждите на реалността. Но вие по-добре и от мен знаете колко трудно и колко дълго време отнема да адаптираме образованието. Тъй като то първо до голяма степен е компетентност на държавите членки, въпреки че вече виждаме развитие по темата и Европейската комисия само преди няколко месеца направи и първия си голям съмит по темите свързани с образованието. Следващият предстои в края на тази година. Тъй като основен акцент там се поставя точно на нуждата на подходящи умения. Това беше и причината преди две години заедно с над 30 представители на неправителствения сектор, на бизнеса, на институциите. Госпожа Фандъкова се присъедини, госпожа Русинова, но също така и вице-президента на Европейската комисия, господин Катайнен, комисар Навръчич също. Да направим и да създадем инициативата и платформата Образование България 2030, която има за цел чрез редовни изследвания и препоръки да допринесе за качественото образование в България до 2030 година. Една от успешните ни инициативи се нарича «Научи ме да умея», през която вече множество млади хора преминаха, за да се научат за това какви са уменията за успех на 21 век. И след това бяха поканени в иновативни и високотехнологични бизнеси, за да видят реално как да пренесат тези важни умения на бъдещето си, бъдещото работно място. I probably need some AI in changing the slides as I keep on speaking, but not changing the slides. You can see some of the photos here from some of the events we did with young people. But now I move on to the next point I wanted to make. Често с екипа говорим, че голяма част от човечеството чака с нетърпение началото на нова година, за да си постави новогодишни пожелания. И те в повечето случаи са свързани с личностно развитие. Но представете си как един 50-55 годишен човек, който през целия си живот, и имаме много такива хора в Европа, е възпитаван и убеждаван, че животът е разделен на етапи. Първо идва ученето, след това идва работата. Най-вероятно и той ще работи на едно и също място през целия си живот, което ще бъде от 9 часа сутринта до 5 часа след обед. Накрая достига до определена възраст, трябва да се отегли и да се пенсионира. Представете си как този човек, чийто живот до момента е преминал по този така много ясно, контролиран, да се каже, до някаква степен сценарий, трябва да се откаже от това сигурно място, удобно място. И, например, да трябва да се напише, да запише за курсове за графичен дизайн или да изучава някой от новите нужни езици за успех, където е обучаван от учител, който може би е 20 или 30 понякога години по-млад от него. И точно за това смятам, че уменията за адаптация към променящата се среда и преодоляване на инстинкта за отхвърляне на новостите ще са абсолютно ключови за успех на всеки един работещ човек и кадър в работната среда. Работата все повече ще бъде сбор от задачи и проекти, изпълнявани в различни функционални, юридически или дори географски рамки, а не толкова дълготрайна, фиксирана заетост с постоянни параметри и задължения, такава каквато по-голяма част от европейците и от човечеството познава. Адаптирането към тези условия наистина ще бъде въпрос на оцеляване, а той до голяма степен е съпроводен и с развитието на технологиите, като AI, автоматизация на рутините задачи и загуба на работни места с такъв профил. Средно 30% от задачите в над 70% от професиите днес могат да бъдат заменени от машини. Това означава, че в бъдеще хора и машини ще трябва да работят все повече в тясна зависимост. Не всички работни места ще изчезнат, но всяко едно работно място ще има нужда от дигиталните умения. Особено в огромната глобална конкуренция, в която работим. Точно затова е важно да работим всички различни застъпени стейкхолдери заедно, за да преодолеем тази голяма празнина, която в момента има в Европа и не само. Много могат да бъдат начините, по които да се справим, но може би има една дума или умение, което обхваща до голяма степен промяната на работа в 21 век и това е предприемаческото мислене. Да, не всеки може да бъде Бил Гейтс или Стив Джобс, но то не ни е и нужно. Имаме нужда от хора, които да се чувстват удобно с това да бъдат самонаети, тъй като в Европа само 37% от европейците са самонаети, което е крайно недостатъчно, за да сме сигурни, че обществото ни е готово за настъпването на промените, свързани с начина и формите на заетост. Затова се радвам, че има изключително много организации, но също така и европейски програми. Виждате, че имаме алокирани над 45 милиарда евро в европейския бюджет до 2020, свързани с по-доброто обучение и даване възможност на повече европейци да надградят на това, на техните знания и да бъдат по-подготвени. Но пак казвам, институциите няма как сами да се справят. Бизнеса и неправителствения сектор са изключителни ключови, за да таргетираме и по-персонализирани мерки, съобразени с разнообразието на работните потребности и отношения, за да можем да се справим с сериозните предизвикателства. I would wrap up in English now with just three main actually sentences that I want to leave you with based on the presentation that I made. First of all, I personally believe that the most important infrastructure in the 21st century is going to be the skills we have and we nurture in every single individual across Europe. Second of all, I think we are faced in a difficult geopolitical situation, but the most difficult global war to find, this will be the one of talents. Talents migrating from one country to another to get a better job. So in order for us to be prepared, I definitely think that what Svetlin said in the beginning, that education is the future of labor, I would transform it of saying that the future of work is skills, skills, skills. Skills necessarily for success in the 21st and 22nd century. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Eva, for making a very strong case for skills for sound foundations in school for everyone, but also for continuous learning through work and longer working lives. Let's shift over to the question of health, because clearly longer working lives are a function of how skilled we are and how nimble we are to adapt to changing circumstances, but also have a lot to do with the workplace and the adaptation of the workplace for us to work longer. So with no further ado, let me hand over to Krista to talk about health.
Thank you very much for the invitation. I would like to give you an overview on what the European Agency for Safety and Health has done over the last years in relation to an aging workforce and occupational safety and health. And I would like to start in the year 2012, the European Parliament and the European Commission asked EU OSHA, that's the abbreviation of European Agency for Safety and Health at Work, to work on a project investigating in the 36 countries the situation of an aging workforce in relation to occupational safety and health. And we started this project in 2013, and the objectives were reviewing the state of the art of knowledge on work, aging and OSH in occupational safety and health, including gender aspects, rehabilitation, and also return to work systems. Then also improve the knowledge on existing policies and initiatives addressing aging and occupational safety and health in 36 member states and in 36 countries, more than 28 member states, also providing reliable information and analysis for policy development in the area of safety and health, including, as I mentioned, rehabilitation and return to work policies, and also exchange the good practice information at company level. So what were the responses from the surveys in 36 countries? Which policies are successful and sustainable? What we can say is that one of the conclusions is that the management of occupational safety and health in the context of an aging workforce requires a multidisciplinary approach in different policy fields and with different actors. And secondly, life course approach, that means to see the needs of all groups, all ages. Different type of measures have to be used at different levels, that means legal, political, finance, and technical measures. A systematic approach, that means to formulate at EU, but also at national level, objective targets which are measurable, have an action plan, prioritize and also monitor, evaluate these programs. And last but not least, engage stakeholders, raise awareness, find a common understanding and a common language, at least at national level, exchange experience. And what we saw a successful factor was centrally coordinated and to have a joined up budgeting. Here you see the integrated policy framework. That means you have to have measures in all these areas. That means socioeconomic measures like pension reforms or to have economic incentives for staying at work. Employment, of course, to increase the participation of older workers. Working conditions and safety and health, that means adapt workplaces to the needs of all groups in the workforce. public health, that means combine workplace health with health promotion, also work-oriented medical rehabilitation, social justice and equality, that means to create a climate of equal opportunity and access to work for all, and education, and I think we heard a lot about before, lifelong learning, of course, is one of the key factors to create and establish and inform an successful policy at national level. What we found out is that only a handful of countries in Europe have established such a unified policy framework covering all these relevant aspects. And we saw that many countries started in the area of raising pension age, and this was not accompanied by other measures or only ad hoc measures in specific fields. The same we see then when we looked into rehabilitation and return to work systems. Why is it important? You know that more than 20% of the EU working population suffer from long-standing illness or health problem, and this figure, of course, is likely to become higher in the future. We will see more chronic diseases within the workforce. It will be more prevalent, like heart diseases, cancer, diabetes, depression, etc. EU OSHA is carrying out an enterprise survey regularly, and there we see that 67% of companies in the EU have measures in place. So which policies on rehabilitation to return to work are successful? Again, it should be an integrative system. Successful frameworks are integrated legal and policy framework. That means return to work systems inscribed in the legislation and coordinated across relevant policy areas. Then inclusive systems, that means these return to work systems target all employees. An important role for employers, they have to be in close contact with people, for example, staying on long-term sick leave, to be in contact at the latest after 4 and 6 weeks. Then early intervention, that means first instance prevention at all stages in the area of safety and health, but also prevention when we talk about training, to have an idea what's needed in the future, and also to have this early contact to absent workers, that you can intervene as early as possible. And then it's a tailored approach. You have to create a system or program in-house which is tailored to the needs of each employee or worker, and there should be individual support to each of them. Coordination mechanism is coordination at all stages, and the employer, for example, in the company should establish case management, and it should be done also at all stages by interdisciplinary teams. Now we looked also at company level, as I said. Also here we see holistic approaches are the most successful. You need a life course approach addressing different needs of young, old people, promoting an intergenerational interaction. Then taking into account factors which are beyond occupational safety and health, that was mentioned, it's training, but good leadership, also the participation of workers, good leadership, and to offer models for a good work-life balance. Then the risk assessment, which should be obligatory in companies, should be diversity sensitive. A combination of primary, secondary, and tertiary prevention, also integrating safety and health into also other areas. That means workplace health promotion is a very important instrument. An overall inclusive management, that means the overall management should include age management, diversity management, gender aspect as well. The human resource area or department is key also to support safety and health related to working time, to career development, also training policy, work-life balance offers. And last but not least, again, this we find in whatever we do in safety and health, but not only in safety and health, good leadership and also social dialogue and workers' participation. I think this I will only mention one of the models or concept used at company level. The workability concept is also contributing to support workability not only at company level but also on the labor market. It's the balance between work demands and individual resources. It stems from Finland when they started their activities related to an aging workforce. It was in the late 60s, and we can, after now many years, say that the evaluation shows that this model contributes to a better workability because it takes into account the work demands, that means work content, workload, work organization, working environment, and the individual resources. That means health and functional capacities, skills, and competencies. Yeah, I'm coming to the. This what we did in the European Parliament pilot project was used later on in our 2 years campaign and the Healthy Workplace campaign for all ages, which is a campaign for 2 years in all member states, even beyond. And you will find on our website all information gathered during this pilot project, but also what we have done during these 2 years together with our partners in more than 30 countries. Thank you very much.
Krista, thank you very much for introducing us to the world of occupational safety and health, which is going to grow in importance as our workforces are aging and we want the workforce to be active for longer. This is a perfect start for our discussion in the panel. I'm pleased to introduce our panelists. First of all, to Krista's right, Jacek Krawczyk, the president of the Employers Group of the European Economic and Social Committee. Next to him, Rebecca Smith, Deputy Director of the Social Affairs Department at Business Europe. Next to her, Thibault Weber, Confederal Secretary of the European Trade Union Confederation. And last but not least, Ingus Alex, State Secretary of the Ministry of Welfare of the Republic of Latvia. So I wanted us to have a discussion on a number of questions on how to promote longer working lives, in the context of what we've listened to in terms of the presentations that set the scene. And I want to start out by asking you, the four of you, from where you sit, to articulate your views on what incentives are necessary for longer working lives, for realizing longer working lives in the context of demographic change, but also, crucially, in the context of accelerating technological change, which is of disruptive nature. What incentives for workers, what incentives for firms? Clearly, a lot is about lifelong learning, is about the continuous adaptation of the workforce, and that is a shared responsibility between firms, between individuals, and the government. But also, what is necessary in order to adapt workplaces in such a way as to allow people to work longer who will have particular needs of adapting workplaces, given health conditions that realize with age. So let me maybe in the first round ask the four of you in turn to reflect on this, but try to keep it brief so that we have an interactive exchange as opposed to you know, another round of presentations. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and thank you for this kind invitation to this important event. Good to be back in Sofia. And perhaps just to say, the European Economic Social Committee is a consultative body of the EU based on the treaty, which this year will celebrate its 60th anniversary. So we are very happy to be around from the very beginning, from the Treaty of Rome. And we comprise three groups, which is employers group that I'm privileged to chair, trade union group, and a group of various interests, mainly different NGOs representing various corners of civil society. Now, this issue that we discuss today is really very much in the heart of what employers group is doing for a long time. And I will follow, of course, the guidelines by the chair, so I will not talk about how much we have done already on the issue of future of work and particularly the skills mismatch that we clearly suffer. But I would try perhaps to trigger the debate and say that, in my opinion, after what we have heard, I think I'm missing at least two or three key words to continue that debate. First of all would be entrepreneurship, promoting entrepreneurship as an attitude, as a very positive way we approach the reality. I think Europe is lagging far behind other regions in the world when it comes to appreciating what entrepreneurship is all about. It's about risk-open type of attitude, which in Europe is not being really highly appreciated and certainly not promoted. I think it has to do with a kind of approach to also education, but also various dimensions of social life that we should really reflect seriously. Second, keyword is flexibility. I know many here don't like this word, but it's necessary. If we go for unpredictable, we cannot come up to unpredictable with a ways of doing things that we are used to for the last 20, 30 years. We cannot try to project for the future what's actually being changed. We have to change this approach utterly. And the third word which is coming across so often is creativity, but I think the issue is how we can turn creativity into something that we can benefit much more also in terms of, yes, exactly, labor market, about the productivity, about efficiency. I think we are in the game where Europe is unfortunately losing its economic leadership in the world. And I think now this digital revolution going from 4.0 to the debate on artificial intelligence within just a few years, it only shows us the level of unknown that we are confronting. And I think, and that's perhaps my concluding remark, that without changing the paradigm by the social partners, becoming much more open for flexibility, for unknown, for taking the risk of dealing with it together, not one on the expense of the other, I mean it, not one on the expense of the other, is the way to go forward. And we have to accept that closer collaboration between academia, business and government is an absolute precondition for any successful approach to dealing with those challenges. Thank you.
Thank you very much. A new paradigm for social partners to interact. In that vein, let me hand over to Rebecca, representing Business Europe.
Thank you, and thank you for the opportunity to be here today. The first thing I'd like to say is I think that we must all acknowledge that the increases in life expectancy that we have in Europe are really an achievement, and I don't think anybody's really mentioned that yet. That's not to say that we should congratulate ourselves, because of course we still have challenges, but it's an important evolution that we have here in Europe and of course in other parts of the world. Of course we have to manage the consequences of that, as has been very clearly outlined by the previous speakers. And I think also from our point of view, it's key that we increase the sustainability of the system, the social systems, the social protection, pension systems overall, but not sustainability for the sake of it, but to make sure that these systems are able to provide adequate benefits, not only for the current generation, but for future generations. And I think we do have a lot of discussions now in Europe at the moment about the solidarity between the different generations. Of course, it's up to member states how they do that, and they will take different measures. But we also need to go much broader than adapting social protection and pension systems, also to look at adaptations and modernizations of our labor markets. You mentioned this issue of a trade-off between demographics and aging population and digitalization. I think clearly for us, it's not a trade-off. We need to deal with both issues and the challenges stemming from those two issues simultaneously. It's not enough to simply look at raising employment of older workers, for example, and we know that we have issues in Europe at the moment in terms of the low levels of employment of older workers, even though it is improving. But it's about increasing rates of employment overall so that we have enough contributions going into the system to make sure it's sustainable in the future. And obviously from an employer's, from a business point of view, for us, this means making sure that labor markets function efficiently. This means creating the conditions so that companies can create jobs and can continue to hire people. And whether that's through avoiding overly restrictive employment protection legislation and also giving a choice in terms of a diverse range of forms of employment. And in fact, we just today published a report that we publish each year now called Business Europe's Reform Barometer. This is basically shows what our member federations, so the employers organizations in the member states and broader across Europe, think are the key issues in terms of reforms. And labor market reforms and a real concern about the slow pace of labor market reforms came top of the list there for our members. And linked to that, also a key issue of skills shortages, which is obviously part of the debate we're having here today. Of course, this is all linked to the issue of technological change. We know that some jobs will go, we know that there will be new jobs, and we know that we're not just talking about the digital sector here, we're talking about across sectors. In most jobs and sectors, workers and companies will have to adapt. And for us, it's clearly important that we accompany those adaptations, that we accompany those developments, but without stifling the innovation in this area. And really, the key should be to make sure that people across the board and across age groups, I would say as well, can grasp the opportunities of digitalization, also adapt to these developments. Of course, at the same time, we need to marry this flexibility, these developments in the labour market, in digitalisation of the economy, with a level of security. And I think for us, of course, we're having debates at the moment on issues around social protection, on issues around working conditions. And of course, we need to find the right balance between flexibility and security, but without stifling innovation and making sure that those individuals, for example, that wish to become self-employed, that wish to work in the gig economy, have the choice and the possibility to do so. Of course, the incentive for companies when it comes to making their own adaptations to deal with an aging population is quite clear. We hear from a lot of companies that they are taking measures in this area, and it's important, of course, that they avoid this kind of cliff edge scenario whereby they reach a certain point and realize that they don't necessarily have the people with the right skills or to move up in their company and to keep the company going. So it's really an issue of business continuity, if you like. And As social partners, maybe Thibault will mention this as well, we've also been working very much on this issue. We recently agreed on a framework agreement on active aging and intergenerational approach. And here we set out a number of tools and possible measures for social partners to work together, as well as either at a national sectoral, but also at a company level to try to deal with some of those issues. I'm not going to go into detail here. Of course, I'm happy to give more information on that. But perhaps just to finish and to make a link with the other topic that we're coming to next, and that is the skills agenda. Clearly, we have to take a life course approach. Here, it's no good starting with measures when people are about to go into retirement. We have to start when people are young, even when they're in education. And of course, the education systems have a role in terms of providing people with adequate level of basic skills, and we know that the EU is underperforming in this area compared to other parts of the world. But they also have a role, along with employers, workers, trade unions and governments, to make sure that people have the right digital skills, the right STEM skills, so that everybody can really be accompanying these transitions in the best way. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rebecca. Let me straight pass over to Thibault to articulate his reflection on this.
Thank you very much. I will speak in French, if you don't mind. I can rant in English, of course, afterward. Merci pour votre invitation. Je vais effectivement réagir en présentant l'initiative qui a été conclue l'année dernière par les partenaires sociaux européens et qui traite précisément de la question qu'on est en train de traiter lors de cette session sur la question du vieillissement actif et de la solidarité intergénérationnelle sur le lieu de travail, sur les lieux de travail. L'année dernière, les partenaires sociaux européens, dont la CES et dont Business Europe, ont conclu un accord autonome, dont il revient aux partenaires sociaux de le mettre en œuvre, sur le vieillissement actif, avec un certain nombre d'outils à destination des négociateurs en entreprise, négociateurs patronaux et négociateurs syndicaux, en matière de vieillissement actif. Je vais rapidement présenter les quelques points clés qui, selon nous, doivent mener à des discussions entre représentants du personnel et entre représentants des employeurs pour traiter de la question du vieillissement actif et de l'anticipation et de la prévention du vieillissement au sein de l'entreprise. D'abord, la question d'avoir un bilan partagé, un constat partagé et d'une évaluation conjointe de la situation de l'entreprise en termes de pyramide des âges, en termes d'activité, en termes de pénibilité d'un certain nombre de métiers. Il est nécessaire d'avoir cette évaluation au préalable d'une négociation ou de discussion entre représentants des travailleurs et représentants des employeurs sur ces éléments. Un deuxième point qui est au cœur des discussions, qui doit être au cœur de la discussion pour traiter de cette question au plus près de la réalité des entreprises et des salariés, c'est la question de la santé et de la sécurité qui est un élément important et qu'on doit prendre pas seulement en termes de compensation ou de réparation des dommages qui auraient été causés, mais en termes de prévention avant tout. Et tous les experts en santé et sécurité vous prouveront, chiffres à l'appui, que des politiques de prévention ambitieuses permettent des économies aux entreprises, mais aussi à nos systèmes de santé, en anticipant et en empêchant quelque part les dommages causés par de longues carrières ou un certain nombre de conditions de travail pénibles. Ces politiques en matière de santé et sécurité, elles doivent non seulement permettre d'adapter les carrières des travailleurs plus âgés, mais aussi d'anticiper un certain nombre de risques qui pèseraient sur les jeunes travailleurs. Beaucoup, là encore, d'experts en santé et sécurité montrent que c'est dans les toutes premières années du travail qu'on fait les plus mauvais gestes ou qu'on prend les plus mauvaises habitudes en matière de santé sécurité, de possibles troubles musculo-squelettiques, et pas forcément que dans les emplois les plus physiques. Donc il y a un enjeu autant à agir sur la carrière des travailleurs les plus âgés que de faire de la prévention et de l'action auprès des plus jeunes. Et sur ce point-là, la question de la solidarité intergénérationnelle, de l'échange entre les travailleurs les plus âgés et les plus jeunes est particulièrement importante. La question des politiques de formation est clé, ça a déjà été évoqué, je ne vais pas forcément revenir dessus, mais il est clair qu'à l'avenir, que ce soit d'un point de vue public ou au sein des secteurs et des entreprises, il y a besoin d'un investissement très fort en matière de formation, et on est persuadé, non seulement la CVS, mais je pense en tant que partenaire socio-européen, que c'est un effort conjoint et ça doit faire l'objet d'un dialogue social très fort pour s'assurer que et les entreprises et les travailleurs seront équipés des bonnes compétences demain. Et puis enfin, un dernier point qui est la question de l'organisation du travail lui-même, de l'organisation de la production elle-même, sur la question du temps de travail, des possibles arrangements et des possibles arrangements qu'on peut trouver en matière de travail pour adapter non seulement les postes de travail à la santé des travailleurs et permettre un vieillissement actif, mais aussi pouvoir travailler en amont sur les possibles discriminations ou stéréotypes qui peuvent exister et qui existent parfois entre travailleurs de différents âges, qui est un point important. Je finirai en faisant juste une remarque. Au cours de ces deux jours, là on est en train de traiter plus particulièrement de la question démographique, mais au cours de ces deux jours, vous allez sans doute évoquer la question technologique traiter de manière plus large la question de l'avenir du travail. On oppose souvent la technologie et l'emploi. C'est vrai qu'il y a des risques très forts quand on parle de robotique, quand on parle d'intelligence artificielle, sur les emplois tels qu'ils existent aujourd'hui. Je pense qu'il faudrait aussi voir la manière dont, d'une manière européenne, on peut traiter cette question, notamment par le dialogue social, en faisant des nouvelles technologies un plus pour le vieillissement actif et pour les travailleurs. Je vais vous donner quelques exemples. Au-delà de chaînes de production ou alors de process de services complètement automatisés, on peut regarder aussi du côté des entreprises dans lesquelles il y a des robots collaboratifs qui, au lieu de remplacer les travailleurs, les assistent dans leurs tâches et permettent d'effectuer des tâches moins difficiles en remplaçant le travailleur quelque part sur les tâches soit les plus répétitives, soit les plus difficiles. Il y a un certain nombre de cas et d'entreprises qui ont réussi à mettre en place ce type de politique et parfois même à créer des emplois en obtenant des gains de productivité avec la mise en place de ces robots collaboratifs. Pour nous, il s'agit d'un point d'entrée essentiel quand on parle de l'avenir du travail, et j'espère que c'est un point qui nourrira les discussions ces deux jours, mais aussi plus largement le dialogue social en Europe dans les années à venir.
Thank you very much, Thibault. A lot on the table that merits greater probing. But before we do so, let me hand over to Ingos for the last intervention in this round.
Thank you. Sorry. Thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank the Bulgarian presidency for organizing this conference and also for inviting me to participate in these interesting discussions. For Latvia also, demographic challenges, in particular aging and depopulation due to immigration and negative natural growth, are very important in many policy areas, be it future of work, education, or social protection and pensions. In view of these challenges, I think it's vital to have efficient policy responses aimed to promoting longer, healthier and more productive lives, working lives, as well as job quality. And it's very crucial to ensure that all of the relevant policies go hand in hand, that the common goal is visible and understandable for all, and it's very clear. Of course, I can agree that in labor market situation is less favorable for older workers when compared to other groups, and in case of job loss, transition to a new job may last significantly longer for older persons than for younger ones. And next to outdated qualifications and skills, such factors as poor health, low mobility, and care obligations may impede older persons from finding a suitable new job. and some previous speakers say, and I agree, there is a necessity for concrete support of the older workers to overcome these obstacles. And changing the labor markets create challenges for people with outdated skills, yes. And here an appropriate policy response is lifelong learning. Timely support for workers under the risk of the job loss may facilitate transition between jobs and reduce also public expenditures. And from my point of view, public employment services have a crucial role in dealing with the challenges of an aging workforce. And there is a demand for more individualized support to achieve better labor market outcomes, in particular where individual obstacles like poor health or addiction have been to tackled, and there is a necessity for specific individual job search plans or individualized attitude to each person who searching for job. In Latvia, the National Active Aging Strategy was prepared in cooperation with social partners and adopted by the government in 2016. And it aims to prolong working lives with measures for persons at risk of losing their job and workers who need workplace adjustments. I must say that lifelong learning rates in Latvia are below the European average, and there is necessity to promote participation in lifelong learning activities. And now there are financial incentives in place targeted at both workers and also companies. Also, last year, the Ministry of Education in our country started a new lifelong learning program, primarily targeted at older workers in jobs with relatively low wages. And also, our public employment service pays attention to raising awareness about aging workforce, for example, by organizing dedicated discussions at regional level about the potential of older workers and the need to fight against any stereotypes. It's very crucial. Also, from the point of view of the pension system in Latvia, includes incentives to prolong working life. There are two main factors determining the amount of pensions. It's social insurance contributions made during the working life, and also employment record as qualification period, as long you work, the better, the bigger your pension is. When making retirement decisions, people often consider employment opportunities and job quality. Therefore, it's important that social partners, in particular employers, also address the needs of aging workforce and pay attention to providing safe and healthy workplaces. That's from my side all. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ingus. Let me pose a question to the entire panel, and you know, you can volunteer. And let me sharpen a little bit the issues, right? So we're beginning to see the aging process play out. At the same time, we see that older workers are less likely to be employed. Like Ingus said, take longer to transition from one job to the other. We know from PIAAC adult skills assessments that on a number of skills, older workers are less skilled than younger workers and more likely to be employed in the type of jobs that are more prone to automation. So are we looking at a situation where technological change will make what is already very difficult, meaning to extend longer working lives, even harder? Or does technology allow for the kind of innovation that is needed in order to facilitate longer working lives? And what new partnership is needed? Some of you were calling for greater partnership and some of you were reporting on greater partnerships between social partners, both you know, at the EU level and further down at the company level, in order to find these solutions which are very often going to be preventive solutions. So how can these partnerships really, you know, find solutions to what is going to be perhaps a much, much bigger challenge than we may agree today?
Thank you. Okay, I think that The key word here is, I believe, transition. I think we're talking about transition. I think where we are today, when we're going to end up in 20 years, is indeed quite different. But I think the challenge is not only what is in 20 years from now, but how we're going to get there. And I think, having talked about that, I think we need to really think about that as a kind of change management, massive change management process that we have to really undergo with all the good conditions for making it a success. So clearly, I think there is no time here to discuss what would take a good change management. But I think that all the stakeholders have to get engaged, otherwise this massive change management will not happen. Second, I think we should avoid, really in that debate, exaggeration that the whole world is going to change. I think there will be a big amount of traditional job services that will remain. And here I don't want to jump too far because my two colleagues from the EFC tomorrow will speak about the committee opinion on future of work, but both they're here at the table. So, but just to tell you that we did the work on the committee on the pillar of social rights 2 years ago, and we agreed between the three groups that the issue of future of work is essential for the pillar of social rights as such in the European Union. But having said this, we also agreed that we need to think about transition, not only from the point of view how we can protect the groups you have mentioned, but also how can we enable them to adjust to the new reality. So I think it's both. And here I would say that I think the lady MEP, she said, okay, we've committed so much European funding to the skills. I think I would love to be able to measure efficiency of these spendings and then being targeted for this transformation. How much we really make a contribution to prepare the mid and older generation, the labor market, to these challenges ahead. Last but not least, I think still the criteria of employability in case of skills should be one of those very important criteria. We don't do it for keeping up with the overall transformation change, challenges of the 4.0 whatever AI transformation. We do it for people to be employed. And I agree with the colleague from the ETUC, there are many challenges here that we need to address, but employability is bottom line. So we need to keep all these discussions close to the labor market, close to the labor market requirements. Otherwise, I think the scarce resources we have, and please don't forget that we are unfortunately going to become a little bit smaller as a union. We have some budgetary constraints as well. We need to make much better decisions on what we want to support. And I believe that gets us down to the labor market. It is foreseeable trends, expectations, business, unions, everybody really has to talk much closer. Thank you.
Thank you, Jacek. Others on the panel?
Maybe it's a bit a general remark, but when we talk about the future of work and technologies, we are talking a bit as if technology or the technological wave will destroy everything or change everything by its own, alone. But in fact, it will depend on many choices made by humans. Political choices, choices made by employers, companies, choices made through social dialogue. So it's not like as if it will happen overnight, first, and it's not like if it's in a new invisible hand that will make everything change from one day to another. We are in the moment where we have choices to make, and I will give you an example. The headlines now are talking about artificial intelligence. Very important topic. But, again, isn't it now the time to establish some standards, some European standards, on the way European artificial intelligence should or not impact the workplaces and workers and companies? I mean, we are still able to shape the digital future, so let's make it.
I think that the technological progress will help also for some specific groups for integration in the future labor market, and I think not only for the older persons, but also for the persons with disabilities, and maybe there is also some new ways how to integrate the persons in labor market with the help of the new technologies. I think it's quite significant question from that point of view.
Rebecca?
Thank you. I mean, we believe very much that technological developments will allow for innovation to facilitate to longer working lives. We're certainly on that side of the debate. And maybe just to pick up on a point that Thibault made, standards. Of course, we need to accompany these transitions, but also maybe to create a bit of debate here as well. I mean, it depends what is meant by standards, because that word always fills me with a little bit of concern, because it sounds like we want to harmonize, we want to standardize the way that things are done. And of course, for us, it's about letting these developments happen and accompanying them. And we won't stop them. Of course, we can make sure that we have policies to at a European national level, or also join together as social partners to work on these issues. But changes have happened before, and I think had we stood in the way of those changes, we wouldn't be where we are today in terms of innovation and industrial development. So standards, okay, and it's maybe the word that I have issues with, but what kinds of standards do we want? What kind of policies do we want? And we mustn't forget that people also choose often these forms of work. It's not always an obligation for people.
Thibault?
It's not necessarily about the form of work that people choose or not. I would just say, but to reply, that the first producers for standards in Europe are companies and industries themselves. I mean, on production processes, on machines, on processes. I mean, we can talk about not necessarily legislation, why not, but also standards, strictly standards in standardization process, where, for example, on new types of machine, cobots, artificial intelligence, we can have strict standards that will be used by the industry to use the same technologies. And using this process, that is an added value, an asset for the also for the sectors and the companies, we can also set some ethical or practical standard that could also protect the companies, but also the workers.
Whether we call it setting standards or whether we call it accompanying people in this transition, what we see is that technology doesn't necessarily lead to, on aggregate, the destruction of jobs. It may actually create more jobs than it destroys, but it will create different jobs from the jobs that it destroys, meaning the job that I will lose as a result of technology is not the same job that will open up, and I am not necessarily well placed for that new job. So we will see distributional effects, and we will see disruption in terms of distribution. So can I get your reflections a little bit on how to deal with that? Some of you have referred to prevention and trying to help people, to accompany them along the way by helping them in a preventive way. Others, Ingos was talking about the importance of public employment services to ensure a swift transition. Rebecca was talking about flexibility and security, and evoking in some sense a fresh look at the right balance for flexicurity, the two having to go together. How do we manage the fact that we will see, and we are seeing, this distributional effects? Whose job is it to respond to this, and how do we respond to this? Jacek.
Well, I always use this example because aviation is my major field of expertise, and if we today imagine there's 50 airplanes above Sofia, in 10 years will be 5,000. Drones, planes, and we have to coordinate them, have to manage them. It's just 10 years from now. If we wanted to fly pilotless planes, we could do it tomorrow. It's more the problem of passengers, not technology. But do we know what skills we need for the air traffic management in 10 years? Not yet. I think that here we have to really keep ourselves open and be very alert to how we implement those changes. I want to refer to what you have said, that it's also our choice to what extent and how fast we want to progress with some of these already ready solutions for implementation. The group, we did a study on the skills mismatch, how really big problem it is for the European business. And our study provides that this mismatch reduces EU productivity by 2%. It's like 80 euro cents per hour of work in average in the EU. It's a huge factor. If you look at that for the last 5 years, the productivity increases in the EU by 1% per year. So clearly skills mismatch, because it, I think, relates a great deal to what you have asked for, is really a major major challenge. But what I want to say is that I think that there is an element of insecurity that will remain. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying let's leave it open. But if you look at the pace of those changes, the speed of those changes in so many sectors, I think that perhaps we too much focus on what is already being a result of those changes. We don't really anticipate fully as a societies and the governments whether we really want that progress to go everywhere as it does today with the speed it does its own. We don't really think of the societal consequences. We don't anticipate enough what kind of progress we really want at what pace. I think here the role of organized civil society, for instance, should be tremendous. Why civil society is not really made an equal partner to discuss all these issues? It's not only about social partners, but there's so much beyond social partners in a society. I think they can also play a tremendous role in that debate and also on the ability of society to absorb the consequences of these upcoming changes.
If nobody else wants to respond to that question, I can pose you the final question to reflect a little bit on all that's been said with the request for a quick answer because we're running out of time. So we're in the middle of the discussions around the new multi-annual financial framework for after 2020. Eva was, you know, referring to, you know, European structural funds being used for skills. Jacek, you were, you know, putting it a little bit in question. For each one of you, a quick response. In order to make sure that we actually see longer working lives and we have more active aging at a time when technological change is disruptive, both making it more difficult but also providing new opportunities for extended working lives, what do we need to see more of, and what do we need to see less of in structural funds focused on active aging?
I hope you are not expecting me the miraculous answer on that. I would say firstly that, and I had the opportunity to express our opinion on the first, let's say, reflection made by the European Commission on the next MFF, that if you look at the first scenarios, the next priority that should be financed in the next MFF, or where we should find new fresh money, are external borders and defense. Is it the priority on the topics we are talking about today? I'm not sure. So this is where the structural funds, in particular ESF, for example, the European Social Fund, should play a very important role in the future, and in particular on continuous vocational education and training. Of course, I will not, you know, sum up all the challenges here, but we are also currently working as European social partners with the employers at European level on continuous vocational education and training, on employee training, and this requires further investment at EU level, of course, with the participation of EU fund and a further effort made by EU fund, but also by companies and sectors themselves. And one should remind that that during the crisis, many companies, big or small companies, were cut their budget on training. because of many situations. You know, the idea is not necessarily to blame people and companies who faced the crisis, but we should remind that that one of the big challenges is how to reinvest in education, whether it is initial education or continuous education.
Yes, I think there is a necessity for investments from European structural funds in the next planning period, also for addressing problems concerning aging of population and changing in labor force. And I think the key word is life cycle approach, and everybody must get the right support and right moment, and there is a necessity to address especially problems with older workers and persons with disabilities, and how to integrate there in most appropriate way in labor market and also in society as such. Thanks.
I mean, for us, I think the focus of the MFF and of spending in the EU in general as well should really be in growth enhancing investment. So we're talking about education, training systems, but also childcare. We're having, as you know, a big discussion at the moment at a European level about work-life balance. And for us, the real focus in order to make sure that people with children and people with caring duties are able to actively participate in the labour market is really about investing in childcare and other care facilities. I would also say, I mean, it's very timely that you asked the question on the MFF, because we just today published as European Social Partners a statement on the MFF, not about the content, but actually our biggest concern at the moment is the delay in taking a decision on this. We feel it's a very pressing issue, and we know that there are discussions going on in Council at the moment, and actually the problem is that the longer that we wait, the more uncertainty there will be about where the future spending will go. So for us, it's really also this sense of urgency to take a decision. So good that you ask, because we just published that today.
Well, with this, you can tell that it's already many years ago, one of the prime ministers, when they negotiated the MFF, said, next time we're going to kill each other. It's been like 12 years ago or more, so now it's again the same story. I think that we are talking issues which are also very much subject of subsidiarity. We have to keep it in mind. European Union competences on many of the issues we discuss here are also very limited. Discussing labor market, discussing some of the policies here, we have to make sure that we reach consensus at the political level amongst the member states, and this should not be taken for granted. I don't really like this kind of European narrative, which is not reflecting on what are the needs of the European member states. It is not correct. But apart from that, I believe that we should use the criteria of employability as a really very important criteria for allocating our structural funds, and not to perhaps necessarily follow the practices from the last years, where the European Social Fund was used as perhaps the best way to create a lot of consulting business in Europe for God knows what purpose. Having said this, I would also like to see how we measure efficiency of these funds, how we measure efficiency of spending this money from the point of view of the purpose we agreed to finance. I think it's very important to keep ourselves accountable, because we have a lot of challenges and we don't have enough money to cover these costs. Last but not least, it is the business that creates jobs. It's not the Santa Claus. Business needs to have a favorable environment to hire people. People with the right skills and right motivation. So business needs also the right conditions to grow. And this should not be forgotten. Thank you.
Thank you very much. With this, this is all we have time for. Let me thank you very much for your participation and for this rich discussion. I think we all in the various interventions highlighted the fact that longer working lives require investments in skills along the life cycle, starting very early. Rebecca was making reference to early child care. And we heard at the beginning by the mayor, the emphasis on early childhood education. I think this is the perfect segue to the next session after the coffee break. But let me thank you very much for this discussion. I think it was very interesting.